Revenue from contracts with customers. So this is a very comprehensive standard on revenue recognition. When should revenue be recognized and how much revenue should be recognized? That is covered by this standard. This standard will replace three accounting literature. One. Ind AS 11 was construction contract, okay? So that will not be covered, or that is not applicable now. Then Ind AS 18, and one more, guidance note on real estate transactions. These three are not applicable anymore. From 1/4/2018, these three standard and guidance note will be replaced by Ind AS 115. This standard now is a very comprehensive standard. It covers different aspects of revenue. Revenue is one of the most important numbers in the financial statement. If you ask me which is the most important number in the entire financial statement, so either it is, you can say revenue or the profit, top line or the bottom line. People give lot of importance to revenue. Okay, companies take so much of efforts to increase their revenue because investors, potential investors, look at the revenue figures. It affects the valuation of the company. Why do you think companies like Flipkart, Amazon spend so much of money on advertisement, marketing, discount, coupon? In spite of the fact that they are incurring losses, but still they spend a lot of money on marketing, advertisement. Why? Because it will increase their revenue. And then in future, if they get a lot of revenue, then they can sell the company or the brand to another company at a very higher price. So this affects the valuation of that brand or that company. That you can tell to the investors that, see, we have generated revenue of 6,000 crore rupees in 1 year. You may not tell them how much profit you generated, might be loss also, but at least top line is very, very high, and that increases the value of the company. So this standard will plug all such loopholes, where if you artificially try to increase the revenue, the standard may not allow you to do that. Is it right? So revenue is something which every business entity would like to have more and more of it. It is often a sign that the business is growing. It is also one of the most important factors analyzed by the financial analyst and other stakeholders. Very important variable in the financial statement is revenue. Valuation of the company to a large extent nowadays depend on the revenue, how much revenue the entity can generate. So all these recent generation e-commerce companies, okay, the names you know, Paytm, Flipkart, Amazon, okay, Ola, Uber, and hundreds of such companies, they're continuously giving you more and more discount, this coupon, that coupon. Why? So as to increase their revenue. And see the valuation of such companies. It has run into now billions of dollars. Are they actually making that much profit? The answer is no. Some of them are into losses also. I don't know whether it is true or not, but Flipkart is continuously making losses. even though their revenue has gone into billions of dollars and valuation has gone into billions of dollars. So what the owners did? Increase the valuation, sell the stake to even a bigger investor, and then exit from the company. Now they have billions of dollars in their pocket. What will the other investor do? Repeat the process. Is it right? What will the other investor do? Repeat the process. He will sell it to again another investor at a higher valuation. So that will continue, and ultimately who will suffer? The last one in the chain. But who will be the last one? We don't know. Okay. So this standard would try to plug some of the loopholes which companies use in manipulating the revenue figures. It is simple to state that you should recognize revenue on accrual basis when it arises. But the problem is identifying the point when it arises. So this standard will tell you when to recognize revenue. The focus you will find many paragraphs are on this, when to recognize the revenue. In basic accounting classes you will be taught follow accrual method of revenue recognition, but actually they will not tell you exactly the cutoff point when the revenue should be recognized. If you receive an order from a customer, is it the point of time when the revenue should be recognized? No, that is not the point. In this chapter we'll discuss when, this simple question, when will you recognize revenue in this case? Or if suppose you are a person who has been given a contract to construct a building and it will take 3 years to construct that building, when will you recognize the revenue? After 3 years when the building is complete, or maybe you can recognize on some percentage completion basis also. Is it right? So even the long-term contracts are covered by this standard. Or if you have committed to sell a machine, two machines, machine A, machine B, this will be sold in 2019, this will be sold in 2022. Customer makes a lump sum payment now. He says, take this 5 lakh, give the delivery in 2019 and 2022. How to recognize the revenue and how much revenue should be recognized? These are the issues which are challenging nowadays. As the business models are changing, the standard also needs to be upgraded. It was found that the old standard, Ind AS 18, or accounting standard 9, now they have become little outdated in terms of the latest changes which have been taking place in the business models. How to do accounting of the changing business scenarios? Ind AS 115, a comprehensive standard, IFRS team, US GAAP team, they have come together and they have designed this standard. Okay. For small trader, this can be a simple issue. For a kirana wala, this is a simple revenue recognition. But for big businesses, like for example, real estate companies, construction company, information technology company, telecommunication company, and many other, deciding the point of recognition and the quantum of revenue to be recognized can be a complex issue. You will see some complexities soon when we start taking the examples. Okay. If there are no proper guideline available for revenue recognition, so the purpose of the standard is that now all companies will have to follow Ind AS 115. All Ind AS companies will have to follow same standard. So there will be a consistency in the accounting. Not only that, there can be a comparison of revenue figure of one company with the other companies also. If different companies follow different practices, then even to compare their top line is difficult. Example, printed in your book. Everything is printed. For example, imagine that you are a dealer in a construction equipment. What is your business? construction equipment, okay, you receive an order to sell specialized machine on 28 December 15 and to provide service for the next 5 years. So when did order receive? When did the company receive the order? 28 December. So on 28 December they received the order. What is the order? To sell the machine and then to provide the services over the next 5 years. So actually there are two transactions that will take place. Sale of machine and then to provide the service for next 5 years. So how many performance obligations you have? Two performance obligations. Sale of the machine, providing of service. See the complication. A single consolidated amount was agreed as consideration for machinery and servicing. But what the parties have negotiated? A single amount. This amount I will pay you, customer is saying, you sell me machine and you give me service for the next 5 years. Like it happens when you buy a car. We buy a car, he gives me the car and he gives me 3 years of free service, 6 years of free service, etc. Are you only paying for the car or are you also paying for the service? You are paying for the service also. But have you ever done such accounting where you have divided the consideration received from the customer into two parts? No, 11, 12, 13, 14, you are taught the same entry, bank account debit to sales account. But now you will not do that. You will find out how much is for machine, how much is for service. Machine is transferred now, so that portion of the consideration applicable to machine will be recognized as revenue. But that portion of revenue for future services will be deferred, will be treated as an advance received from customer, and over 5 years, as and when you will render the service, you will recognize it. Okay. Now see, the problem says further, the customer would like a delivery by the end of January 2016. See the challenge, order received on 28 December. January is the delivery date. And between the two dates, there is an year-ending date. Your year-ending date is December 31st. Without the proper guidance, you may be tempted to book the revenue in 2015 itself for both the sale of the machinery and servicing, as it is going to show a higher revenue figure and therefore make your business look better. Is it a right accounting? Say yes or no. Some of you are sleeping on the first bench also. Amazing. Or if you want to sleep, go to last bench. Without the proper guidance, you may be tempted to book the revenue in 2015. If there is no standard, what will you do? You would like to book the revenue in 2015. But what has happened in 2015? You have only received the order. Okay. You want to show a higher sales figure in 2015. More sales, more profit, more EPS, more MPS, more commission to the managing director. Finally, is it right? But this standard will say, as we will proceed ahead, it is not appropriate to recognize revenue in 2015. In reality, as the machine will be delivered in January, and services will be provided in the coming years, the revenue related to services shall not be recognized immediately. So probably in the exam they can convert this into a question. Up to this will be a question, and your institute will ask, do you think the company is justifying in booking the revenue in 2015? So your answer will be no. And then you have to give a detailed explanation of why no, but that we will discuss as we'll go ahead. So Ind AS 115, our present standard, The objective is to give specific guideline on the timing of revenue recognition. Timing means when should revenue be recognized, cutoff point. Because it might shift the revenue from this year to next year or from next year to this year. Like in previous example, the company was trying to shift the revenue from next year to current year. So it will affect the revenue and profit of this year, not next year. But that was wrong. Once you apply 115 properly, revenue will be recognized in the correct accounting period. Revenue will be recognized in the correct accounting period. And second, correct amount of revenue will be recognized, quantum of revenue recognition. Okay. Suppose you are an agent or consignee. Okay. You sell TV as an agent on behalf of a company. So you sell to the customer TV at 10,000 rupees, company gives you 2,000 rupees commission. This standard will say identify your status. Are you a principal or are you an agent? As I have said, he is an agent. What would be the quantum of revenue recognition for this agent? 10,000? Can he show 10,000 as revenue and 8,000 as cost and 2,000 net profit commission? No. The standard says you will show revenue 2,000 only. Your income is commission. You are not the principal. You will not recognize the gross amount. You will not recognize the gross amount. You are only an agent. So in future what will happen? Say you are a company like Flipkart, okay, Amazon. You sell the product of a company. What do? They sell the product of a seller. A TV sold, Sony, 70,000. How much commission these companies get? Say 15%. So 10,500. Some of these e-commerce company right now, what they are doing in order to show a higher revenue, they are showing 70,000 rupees as revenue. But they are merely acting as an agent. They are only agent of the seller. Okay. Once it is proved that he is an agent, we will see afterwards how to identify an agent and how to identify a principal. Once we demonstrate that he is an agent, then he will show a revenue top line only 10,500 rupees, not 70,000. So the standard will deal with principal and agent relationship. Principal will recognize gross revenue. Agent will recognize the commission. Next is the principle of timing and amount of revenue recognition need to be carefully understood, as incorrect interpretation would lead to error in the financial statement. Okay. Now we'll come to what is our agenda for today and tomorrow. Ind AS 115. What are the areas covered by this standard? First few minutes today we'll learn explain and apply the principle of revenue recognition. Under that we have to learn how to identify contracts, identification of performance obligation, determination of transaction price, allocation of the price to performance obligation, and recognition of revenue when or as performance obligations are satisfied. In fact, you will say this is the main part of this standard. Okay. That is, our first part will be to understand the principles of revenue recognition. And it is called a five-step model. The standard is sometimes called five-step model, which five steps already appearing on the screen. We'll discuss later. Right now, agenda. And second, we will discuss the describe the acceptable method for measuring progress towards complete satisfaction of performance obligation. In long-term contracts, we will learn how to calculate the stage of completion. So, which is similar to your accounting standard 7, you can say, or previous Ind AS 11. Is it right? If you are rendering service over a long period of time, how to recognize revenue, how to calculate the stage of completion, then explain and apply the criteria for recognition of contract cost. Now that construction contract or contract costing has also come into this standard only. There are no two separate standards for revenue and one standard for construction contract. Both will be covered by this standard only. So that is your third part. Explain and apply the criteria for recognition of contract cost. Specifically, account for the following types of transactions. Now, there are some special transactions which we will cover: principal versus agent, repurchase agreement, bill and hold agreement, and consignment agreements. These are specifically covered by the standard: principal versus agent, repurchase agreement, bill and hold arrangement, and consignment. And then point number E, account for different types of consideration, including variable consideration, and where a significant financing component exists in the contract. Last one, prepare financial statement extract for contracts where performance obligations are satisfied over a period of time. This is the, you can say, the coverage of this standard, the very comprehensive standard. If you look at it carefully, it merges the two standards that we have been learning for ages. One standard was on only revenue recognition, one standard was on construction contract. Now the two standards have been merged. Plus the basic premise have changed. Our revenue recognition standards so far were based on risk and reward. When should revenue be recognized? In intermediate, I was told, when the risk and reward of ownership is transferred to the buyer, that is the point when revenue should be. This standard shift the base. Now it says when control is transferred to the customer. So from risk and reward approach, we have moved to control approach. When the control is shifted to customer, revenue is recognized. This standard looks at revenue from customer's point of view. The standard looks at revenue not from company's point of view, customer's point of view. When does customer receive goods and service? When does he think, yes, now I have received the goods and service and I have control over these goods and service? That is the point when revenue will be recognized. Substance over form. One of the main principles of this standard is substance over form. So throughout this standard, we will give importance to substance over form, which means the transaction should be recorded according to its substance, economic reality, and not just the form in which the transaction appears. That is legality. Okay. So if you buy a car, you get car, you get free service, okay, you get warranty. Each of them can be separately purchased also. Each of them can be separately purchased also. That means you can tell the company, for example, no, I want only car. How much will you charge? 5 lakh. If I want same service which you give along with car, how much will you charge? 1 lakh. If I want the same warranty which you give to customer, how much will you charge? 2 lakh. So in substance, you are paying for 3. In form, you are paying for 1. If you buy everything together, the company says we will charge you 7 lakh. Okay. But company is not selling you one item. Company is selling you 3 items, substance. So what they will do after this standard, they will divide this 7 lakh roughly in the ratio of this 5:1:2. Sale of car is complete at the time of delivery, control is transferred. Maybe you can recognize revenue at the time of giving delivery, taking consideration, because control is transferred. But these two will be service rendered over 3 years, over 5 years. So even the revenue will be recognized over 3 years or 5 years, whatever may be the case. So therefore, it is written that it indicates that accountant must utilize critical thinking in determining how to present information by assessing the reality of a transaction. You are a new generation CA now, okay? Still time, okay? Some months. So, the moment you become CA, you will find that you have to apply this standard. So now every time revenue takes place, revenue transaction takes place, critically think, what is the substance? Do I need to recognize gross amount, net amount? Do I need to divide the consideration into two or more parts? Okay, when should I recognize the revenue? Are we a principal or are we an agent? And then accordingly you will recognize the revenue. Problem will be for GST purpose, the amount will be different. In case of GST, if you sell the car, they will ask you to pay the GST on the entire amount of the car. That is GST. So that will be another set of records you have to maintain for GST purpose. But for accounting purpose, you will have to apply Ind AS 115. Okay. For accounting purpose, you will have to apply Ind AS 115. Because many student can ask this question, how are you going to pay GST? Are we going to pay GST also according to 115? Whatever little knowledge I have on GST, no. For GST, you have to apply GST laws and they will tell you the valuation rule for the car. Okay? So Ind AS 115 is called a five-step approach towards revenue recognition. So you have to remember these 5 steps. This can be a theory question also. What are the 5 steps in revenue recognition as per Ind AS 115? So then just write down these 5 steps I have written in your book. First step is identification of contract with customer. First step is called identification of contract with customer. So there are 2 keywords here, contract and customer. There must be a contract, as you know, oral or written, implied or explicit. And the contract must be with whom? Customer. Contract must be with a customer. Who is a customer? We'll discuss later. Who is a customer? Even that is defined in the standard. Who is a customer? Is a student customer of a teacher? No. Don't get emotional. Answer in the context of Ind AS 115. Yes. So these are the questions. First, that party must be a customer. Okay, suppose Mayawati comes to your store, example, and says, give me 5 kurtis, okay? And then you say, I will not raise the bill on this person. Is Mayawati your customer? Hello? No. We'll answer this question later. First, you know, who is a customer? A policeman comes and says, give me this product. He takes the product, goes. Will it be recognized as a revenue? We'll see that. So these questions are pending. Student, whether he's a customer, Mayawati, policeman, is it right? Then identification of performance obligation. Second step is to find out the performance obligation in the contract. What the seller and the buyer are supposed to do? Performance obligation. If you are a car dealer, your obligation is to sell the car, provide the free services, provide the warranty. Is it right? In one earlier example of a company selling heavy equipment, your obligation was to sell the equipment and provide services for 5 years. Because your revenue will be allocated according to the performance obligation. Are you supposed to perform one obligation, two obligations, three obligations? Is it right? So identification of performance obligation. What the seller is supposed to deliver. Then third is to determine the transaction price. Determine the transaction price. We'll discuss. These are steps right now. And next 3-4 pages will discuss all these steps in detail. Step number 4 is allocation of the price to performance obligation. Suppose you have more than one performance obligation. Then you have to allocate the transaction price over the performance obligation. You have sold one heavy equipment plus you have committed to provide service for 5 years. Suppose the transaction price is one single price, 6 lakh rupees. You have to apportion that 6 lakh over the heavy equipment price and the service. Is it right? And then recognition of revenue. When or as the performance obligations are satisfied. How to recognize the revenue? So step number 1, identification of contract with customer. Step number 2, identification of performance obligation in the contract. Step number 3 is to determine the transaction price, which normally will be given to you in the question. Your task will be basically this point number 4 and 5. You have to allocate the transaction price according to performance obligation and recognition of revenue as and when the performance obligations are satisfied. Okay. Next paragraph, definitions. Some basic definitions we will discuss in this standard. Like for example, the name of the standard is revenue from contracts with customers. In the heading only there are 3 items which will be defined: revenue, contract, customer. Contract definition long back. Those happy days when there was no articleship, no homework, only few subjects. Okay. So you have learned in contract that it is an agreement between two or more parties. So in this chapter it will be an agreement between the seller and the buyer. Agreement should be written or oral? Written or oral or whatever, implied. Is it right? When you go to the AS Foundation office and say I want to take admission in financial reporting subject, do you sign an agreement on a 100 rupees stamp paper? No, you didn't sign. What if I stop providing you the service now? I will say do the remaining portion yourself. Trust on me. Wow. That lady saying no trust. Oral agreement. Implied agreement that if we pay the fees for FR, it is assumed that as per the syllabus, you will complete all the chapters in the given time also. But your syllabus has become so vast that even though we try to take it every day without any break, it doesn't get over only. So next time before we announce the batch, we will announce, let's say, 2 years. Okay, 2.5 years. so that it will be finished on time, because by the time you finish one chapter, one more new chapter the institute adds in the syllabus. Between two or more parties, seller and buyer, that creates enforceable rights and obligation. Both parties have rights and both parties have obligation. Seller has a right to demand consideration. Buyer has a right to demand product or the service. Is it right? That has been agreed upon. Buyer has an obligation to pay the consideration also. Seller has an obligation to deliver the product and service. Enforceable. Both parties can enforce the contract on the other. If it is not followed, then you will go to court to get your rights, consumer court. That sir has not completed the syllabus, ask for refund. Okay? No problem. Who is a customer? Customer is a party that has contracted with the entity. So there must be a contract with the entity to obtain goods or services. To obtain goods or services that are an output of an entity's ordinary activities in exchange for consideration. So we have to identify who is a customer. First question, whether a student is a customer of a teacher?
Yes.
There is a contract, oral contract in this example, to obtain goods or service. You will receive the study material, okay, goods. You will receive the training, coaching, guideline, that is service, that are an output of an entity's ordinary activity. That are an output of the entity's ordinary activities. So what is the output of our entity? Books and teaching, is it right? That is output for us. And it is our ordinary activity. It is our day-to-day activity, normal activity, the activity for which the entity has been created. Is it right? In exchange for consideration. In exchange for consideration. Mayavati comes to your shop and says, give me 4 kurtis, jumbo size. Okay. You can't dare to ask the consideration also. Is Mayavati your customer? No, the last point is missing there. In exchange for consideration, you treat it as a sales promotion expense, okay? Treat it as a cost, charge to P&L account, but do not book it as a revenue. There is no consideration. Policeman comes, takes a product, goes away, doesn't pay. Is police your customer? Treat it as a staff welfare expense. Treat it as an environmental protection expense, debit to environmental promotion expense account, okay? Protection account. This is what companies do. All bribes they charge under this kind of head, staff welfare expense, sales promotion expense, environmental protection expense, okay? We don't do that. What are you looking at me? Correct. Student welfare expense, not staff welfare expense. Income. What is income? Income word you have used hundreds of times in your life. What is income? Yes, aap. Income. Huh. You are a student of CA final. economic benefit derived by the entity. Okay? It can be monetary or non-monetary, okay? That is what normal people will define. ICI has its own way of explanation. It is the increase in economic benefit. So you use this word economic benefit, I am very glad. It is increase in economic benefit during the accounting period. So that means something which is an economic benefit. For the purpose of accounting, this income must accrue in the accounting period in the form of inflows or enhancement of asset. So either you get inflow, some asset comes in like cash, bank, or it is increase in the value of an asset. Enhancement of an asset is also income, or decrease of liability. So decrease of liability is also an income that results in an increase in equity. So any such economic benefit whose impact is on equity, positive impact on equity, that means after this income is recognized, my equity will increase. Equity means your basically share capital plus reserve and surplus. That is equity. So revaluation of fixed asset upward is also an income. Profit on sale of fixed asset is also an income. Profit on sale of investment is also an income. Okay. Income may be revenue, income may not be revenue. Income may be revenue. Like if I sell inventory, it is my revenue, it is my income. But if I sell my car, it is going to generate profit, which is my income, but not revenue. See below last line, revenue means income arising in the course of an entity's ordinary activities. So in this chapter, we have to be careful. This chapter is revenue recognition. This chapter is not about income recognition. Am I clear? So in this chapter, we are not going to cover profit on sale of fixed asset. When selling fixed asset is not my ordinary activity. Profit on sale of investment is my income. But if selling investment is not my ordinary activity, this standard is not applicable. Revaluation of fixed asset upward is my income. This standard is not applicable because it's not a revenue. That results into increase in equity. But they have given one more important line, other than those relating to contribution from equity participant. Issue of share will also increase the equity. But issue of share is a contribution from equity shareholder. Issue of share is not income. Issue of share, not income. It may increase the contribution from equity participant. It may increase equity because of contribution from equity participant, but this is not an income. This standard does not deal with income recognition. It deals with revenue from contract with customer. Okay. All revenues are income, but all income are not revenue. All income are not revenue, but all revenues are income. Performance obligation. What is performance obligation? A promise in a contract with a customer to transfer to the customer either the goods or service, that is, or a bundle of goods or service that is distinct. Distinct means different, separate. Distinct means different or separate, or a series of distinct goods or service that are substantially the same and have the same pattern of transfer to the customer. So that is the meaning of performance obligation, to deliver goods or service. goods or service can be a single unit or it can be a bundle of goods or service. Is it right? Which are distinct. So suppose a student says we want to join for CA final group 1. All subjects, that what we are doing, we are providing a bundle of goods or service. He wants to only attend the FR batch. We are paying for only one single good or service. Similarly, when you buy a car, you say, I want only car, I don't want free service, I don't want warranty, I don't want repairs, maintenance afterwards. Then it is single goods or service. But when you buy the car and along with the car you get other benefits like free service, warranty, it's a bundle of goods or service you are getting. Is it right? Or a series of distinct goods or service that are substantially the same and have the same pattern of transfer to the customer. So sometimes what happens, we purchase say 1 lakh units, but we tell the supplier that every quarter you deliver only 25,000 quantities. I don't have the space to stock 1 lakh quantity. So you supply the same goods over a period of 1 year, 25,000 quantities each. So a series of distinct goods or service that are substantially the same and have the same pattern of transfer to the customer. How will revenue be recognized in this example? Or how will revenue be recognized when all 1 lakh units are transferred? Will it be the same? No. Here, if all 1 lakh units are transferred in one consignment only, revenue will be recognized after the control is transferred to the customer. But here you will recognize revenue in 4 parts. First you deliver 25,000 unit, recognized revenue for 25,000 units. Okay. So in the standard they will discuss all such different possibilities. What is revenue? Revenue means income arising in the course of entity's ordinary activities. All revenues are income. Yes or no? All incomes are not necessarily revenue items. The standard deals with revenue. Is it clear? The standard does not deal with income which are not revenue in nature. There are other standards. For example, interest is an income for an entity. But interest income is covered by another standard. Profit on sale of fixed asset is an income, but that is covered by some another entity. Foreign exchange gain is an income, but covered by some other standard. Okay, lease rental received may be an income, but there may be a separate standard. So now you see the scope of Ind AS 115. Ind AS 115 applies to, because next 3 questions are going to be based on scope paragraph. So listen to me carefully. 115 applies to contracts. There must be a contract between the entity and the customer. The contract must be to deliver goods and service to a customer. Who is a customer? The one who buys the output of the entity. One who buys the output of the entity for a consideration is a customer and will not apply. And will not apply when those contracts are leases. Now, because lease is specifically covered under Ind AS 17. So whatever accounting relating to leases have been covered by Ind AS 17 will be covered under that standard. Then the standard will not interfere, because there is a specific standard dealing with leases. The next is insurance, covered by Ind AS 104, but that is under, I think, revision, and maybe soon this standard will be eliminated. Rights and obligation which will fall within the scope of financial instrument guidance covered under Ind AS 109. Because financial instrument give rise to lot of income. Fair value gain, interest income, dividend income, those are covered by 109. And then rights and obligations which fall within the scope of Ind AS 110, CFS, 111, joint arrangement, 27, separate financial statement, and Ind AS 28, investment in associates and joint ventures. So rights and obligation will be discussed in these four standard. And then point number E underline, because you will get a question soon on this. Non-monetary transaction. So this is one question in the exam. What is the scope of Ind AS 115? So then this much you have to write, five items. That Ind AS 115 applies to contract with customer for delivery of goods and service, but it is not applicable to following contracts. Five items: leases, insurance, then financial instrument, then those consolidated related four standards, and non-monetary transaction between entities in the same line of business. Between entities in the same line of business, underline same, not similar. What is the difference between same and similar? Suppose there is a TV channel, Aaj Tak, okay, and there is a print newspaper. Newspaper, which one? Times of India, okay. Times of India. What they are doing practically also, in the Aaj Tak channel, they will give advertisement of Times of India. In Times of India, sometime you will find there is an advertisement of Aaj Tak. But they are not paying anything to each other. Is it right? Non-monetary transaction between entities in the same line of business. The question is, are they in the same line of business? No. Print newspaper and TV channel are not same line of business. So in this case, the standard is applicable to both parties. Aaj Tak will recognize revenue. Okay, and similarly, Times of India will also recognize revenue. But suppose, we'll change the example little bit. First, let me read the sentence completely. Non-monetary transaction between entities in the same line of business, where this is done to facilitate sales to customer or potential customer. Where this is done to facilitate sales to customer or potential customer. Another TV channel. Zee News. Now, in Zee News channel, Aaj Tak advertisement appears. In Aaj Tak channel, Zee News advertisement appears. This will become same line of business transaction. Then the standard says, you will not recognize revenue. Okay? You are not going to recognize the revenue because this is only done to facilitate sales to customer. Okay, this is same line of business. So this, what is the purpose of such transactions? Does it make much difference to their say viewership? The answer is no. Usually the same person who watches this channel will watch this channel also, and vice versa. Right? So therefore, this standard says your objective of entering into such transaction is only to increase your top line. Increase your top line. Increase your sales. Increase your brand value. And make more gain in the future when you will sell that brand. But actually, there is no commercial substance in this transaction. Which word I used? No commercial substance. This is not revenue. This is not revenue. Suppose these two persons are selling clothes, okay? Example, you are a CA student at the moment. Same cloth, first he sells to him, and same cloth you also sell to him. Same quantity, for example. Same cloth, same quantity. And both of them recognize revenue. So their top line will go up. Can they do that? No. No. They can't do that. I said same. Is it right? This way they are only trying to increase their top line revenue. But there is no commercial substance in that. It does not affect their timing, risk, etc. at anything. This standard will not allow you to do that. Okay. Many companies are boosting their top line by entering into transactions with other companies which are into same business. Okay, you also show sales to me as revenue, I will show sales to you as revenue. The standard says no. Non-monetary transaction between entities in same line of business where this is done to facilitate sales to customer or potential customer will not be treated as revenue. So you will find at the end of your book there is a question number 15. Okay. A TV channel released an advertisement in a newspaper. I have already explained this example. Instead of paying for the same, TV channel allowed the newspaper company a free advertisement spot which was duly utilized by the newspaper company. Aaj Tak is giving ad for Times of India. Times of India is giving ad in its newspaper for Aaj Tak. That is the question. How revenue for this barter transaction in the area of advertisement will be recognized and measured? So first you have to apply in the exam whether it is subject to scope paragraph or not. Non-monetary transaction between entities having same line of business. One view is that it is the same line of business. Both are giving news. Okay. One in print form, one in video form, audio video form. Okay. But other view is that these are two different media. They cannot be treated as same line of business. Because many times the customers are very different from each other. So some of you may be only watching news on TV. How many of you belong to that category who watch news on TV? Oh. Some watch news, some read news on mobile phone only. Mobile phone wane haath uthao. Mobile phone. Some watch, some read on print media like newspaper. Newspaper. So different class of customers are there. Okay. Different target audience is there. Different business. They will recognize revenue. Okay. They will recognize revenue. They will see what is the value of this service. Had I rendered the same space to other, how much amount I would have charged. Am I right? Times of India, what they will do, had I given the same space to any other customer, we would have charged some amount from him. That revenue Times of India will recognize. Similarly, Aaj Tak, had I allowed the same 5 minutes to any other commercial, how much revenue I would have generated, they will recognize according to that revenue. So how will you write the answer in the exam? You will write yes, no, don't know, full stop, next question. Okay. Ind AS 115. excludes non-monetary exchange between entities in the same line of business to facilitate sales to customer or potential customer. This is first we are writing the provisions of Ind AS 115. This is not the conclusion. Now we are linking the case study to the provision of Ind AS 115. In industries with homogeneous products, it is common for entities in the same line of business to exchange products in order to sell them to customer or potential customer other than the parties to exchange. In the current scenario, however, will be covered under Ind AS 115, underline, will be covered under Ind AS 115. Because some students were saying it will not be covered. Since the same is exchange, again underline, dissimilar goods or service. Both of the entities deal in different mode of media. So you will also take the same stand, at least in the exam, print media, radio, then mobile app, television ad are different media. And if there is an exchange of advertisement in different platforms, each party will recognize the revenue. One is print media, other is electronic media. As per 115, an entity shall consider the terms of the contract and its customary business practice to determine the transaction price. So first we have concluded both will recognize revenue. Second is transaction price. Both of them are not charging anything to the other. You give me advertisement in my newspaper, I will give advertisement in your channel. But they have to recognize the revenue. So how to recognize the revenue? By looking at the price at which you would have charged to any other customer. Okay. The transaction price is the amount of consideration to which an entity expects to be entitled in exchange for transferring promised goods or service to a customer, excluding amount collected on behalf of third parties. So transaction price means how much you would have charged to any other person. Transaction price does not include amount collected on behalf of others. So basically GST will not be included in the transaction price. Okay. When you sell goods for 100 rupees and collect 18 rupees as GST, revenue is only 800 rupees. Revenue is only 100. 18 is what you are doing. It is just collecting from the customer and paying to the government. So indirect taxes collected on sale is not revenue. The consideration promised in a contract with the customer may include fixed amount, variable amount, or both. So after defining what is consideration, now finally conclusion is, in accordance with the above, the TV channel and the newspaper company will measure the revenue as the amount they expect to be entitled to. One more question just below that, 16 number. Don't change the page. Continue. Close your book now and answer whether revenue will be recognized or not after reading the question on the screen. A and B are both engaged in manufacturing of bottles. Without reading further, you are saying no. One may be making bottles for shampoos. One may be making bottles for wines. Huh? Bottle for, let's say, cold drink. One is bottle for wine. Then what will be the answer? Let us read further. Don't jump to conclusion. Don't disturb. A Limited as a factory in Gujarat. B Limited as a factory in Maharashtra. Maharashtra. A Limited fulfills the demands of his customer based in Maharashtra by using the bottles manufactured by B. Practical example. Where is A Limited situated? Gujarat. B Maharashtra. But A Limited has got customers in Maharashtra. And reverse, B Limited has got customers in Gujarat. Okay. There are two ways they can handle this problem. practically. Either A, which is in Gujarat, will dispatch all the bottles to its customer in Maharashtra. And B Limited, which is in Maharashtra, will dispatch the customer directly to Gujarat. So you can imagine this will be involving a lot of cost, administration cost, transportation cost. So what they do, if A Limited receives an order in Maharashtra, say 1,000 bottles, it will ask B Limited, you deliver that bottle to the customer. If B Limited receives an order from a customer in Gujarat, it will ask A Limited, you deliver it to the customer. Possible? But is it their revenue? On one hand, they will record sales to customer also. Then they will record sales to this other entity also. But this is about a transaction involving same goods. Barter transaction involving same goods. If they record all transactions in this problem, their revenue will be overstated. Revenue will be overstated. No impact on profit, but revenue will be overstated. Is it right? Now, let us understand with some numbers. CA students can understand only numbers. A Limited directly sells to its customer 1,000 bottles directly, which are located in Gujarat. And A Limited through B Limited sells 1,000 bottles to its customer located in Maharashtra. Is it right? Now A Limited, what it will do? And then what about B Limited? B Limited sells, say, 1,500 bottles to its customer directly. Through A Limited also, it sells 1,000. How much revenue A Limited should recognize? So A Limited can recognize like this. 1,000 units customer. A will say, he is also my customer. A will say, I have sold through B, but he is my customer. So 1,000 direct, 1,000 through B. And A is saying, I have sold 1,000 units to B also. What A is saying? I have sold 1,000 units to B also. So let me recognize this 1,000 also. Actually, they have sold 2,000 bottles. But they may recognize 3,000 bottles. They may recognize, first they will do the billing to this customer, he is my customer. I will do billing to this customer also, he is my customer, only delivery is made through B. And then I am going to bill B Limited also, 1,000. Same thing, B will also bill me 1,000. So both parties are overstating the revenue by 1,000 units. The institute says no, this and these transactions will not be recorded by the companies as revenue. Otherwise, it will be overstatement of revenue. How A and B Limited would recognize the revenue? So as an auditor also, now you have to see whether there is any such arrangement where there is an exchange of same goods between two parties. If the answer is yes, for accounting purpose, it will not be revenue. Maybe for tax purpose, etc., it may be. Is it right? But not for accounting purpose. We are right now student of accounting. So in my books of account, my revenue will not be recorded if it is exchange of same goods. Okay. India's 115 state that it shall not apply to non-monetary exchange between entities in same line of business to facilitate sales to customer or potential customer. In industries with homogeneous product, it is common for entities in the same line of business to exchange products in order to sell them to customer or potential customer other than parties to exchange. For a transaction to qualify as a barter transaction, the exchange shall be monitored in terms of quantities and not in monetary terms. The exchange shall be monitored in terms of quantities and not in monetary terms. Of course, if there are different bottles, if there are, they are different bottles, then both parties will recognize the revenue. Exchanges monitored or settled in monetary terms are not barter transactions. In this case, since both the bottles are being exchanged irrespective of its monetary value, it will qualify as a barter transaction, and because it will qualify as a barter transaction, it will qualify as non-monetary exchange, and therefore no entity, none of the two entities will recognize the revenue. Now your query. Huh. If there is a financial element
involved, how will that be recorded?
What is financial element involved?
Means I sell it to you.
Okay.
And, you sell the same quantity but after a certain point of time.
So after a certain point of time.
Involved.
And then I also return you that same goods. So that is barter.
No, for providing you finance.
Huh. Okay, but you are selling it to me, not to my customer, not to facilitate the sale to customer or potential customer. Not to facilitate sale to customer or potential customer. So you are in that case selling it to me, then it will be recognized as revenue. Again, many times you have to analyze the facts and circumstances of the case. So in your example, there can be some financing component. Maybe after 6 months, I return the goods back to you. Okay. So interest income can be recognized in that case.
I just wanted to confirm one point. The point that was written, that it should be measured in the terms of quantity. So suppose in this financial year, I gave 1,000 quantity to your customer.
Okay.
And you gave only 500 quantities to my customer. Then
okay. 500 you will have to recognize. Who will recognize? The one who has supplied more will recognize. The one who has supplied more. That is her query. And in 1 year you supply 1,000 units. Next year that is reversed. So in that case there will be a financial implication. Okay. There are so many situations which still may not have been covered by the standard because it can't visualize each and every possibility of revenues. Okay. But still, that was a good question. Now, next is one more question just below that. Entities N and S are both engaged in the extraction and supply of natural gas to different parts of India. It is like your previous problem only. Plant N is located in North India, while that of S Limited are located in South India. No problem. N Limited also contracts to supply natural gas customers in South of India. Same problem. It is located in North India, but some of its customers are in South India. Similarly, S Limited contracts to supply natural gas to customers in North India. Consequently, N Limited purchases from S Limited to supply natural gas to customers located in South, and S Limited purchases from N to supply natural gas to customers in North. It will reduce a lot of their time and transportation cost and other headaches. Plus nowadays GST also. Is it right? I'm not sure about that, but yes, you have GST implication. Same state, different states have different implications. The price of natural gas for this transaction would be based on actual delivery date of gas by the either parties. Underline. The price of natural gas for this transaction would be based on actual delivery date of gas by either parties. Further, the parties would do a monthly calculation of supplies and receipt of gas and do a net settlement based on the prices calculated as above. This time there are some different variables coming up. One is that the value of the gas will vary according to the date the delivery will be done. And then they are going to calculate the value of gas received, value of gas transferred, and the difference will be settled on a monthly basis. How will this situation be treated under Ind AS 115? So you have to handle such questions in the exam. First, whether Ind AS 115 be applicable or exempted. Will both parties recognize revenue or both parties will not recognize revenue? Both parties will recognize the revenue, because here the value of the gas will change with the change in the prices, and they are doing the settlement on a monthly basis. Ind AS 115, first line is same in all the three answers. Excludes non-monetary exchange between entities in same line of business to facilitate sales to customer or potential customer. For a transaction to be qualified as a barter transaction, the exchange shall be monitored in terms of quantities, underline. The exchange shall be monitored in terms of quantities and not in terms of monetary terms. Exchange settled in monetary terms shall not be classified as barter. These are the provisions of Ind AS 115. In this case, entities N and S operate the same line of business. Okay, that is satisfied. Agree to supply natural gas to each other's customer to ease the supply in geographically close areas. However, underline, they calculate the price based on the date of delivery and do a net settlement. So exchange is monitored on monetary basis. Thus, the above stated situation does fall within the scope of Ind AS 115. So these two lines you have to connect in the exam. N Limited will book revenue from sale of goods to X Limited and also book revenue from sale of goods to its customer in the south of India. N Limited will also book purchases of goods from S Limited. Bottles, huh? A enters into a customer with agreement with customer in another state.
And B will supply the bottle. Correct. So now the quantity is 1,000.
Quantity is 1,000. Okay, this question you are talking about, huh?
Yeah, so the quantity is 1,000.
Quantity is 1,000. Okay.
So that one element is done. Now for B, who has a customer in A state.
Okay. Same thing. You are repeating the question only, huh?
No, the quantity is 500.
So the 500 revenue you have to recognize.
And the
but who knows about next year, na?
So
you have to close the books at the end of the year. So at the end of the year, there has to be a recognition of that remaining 500. What we are talking, 1,000, if it matches, then there is no need to recognize. But 1,000, one party, 500, another party, revenue of 500 will have to be recognized.
But the control is not transferred.
Where control is not transferred? You've given bottle, now he can enjoy. So A has to receive the consideration for 500 bottles from B. So A will recognize 500 extra. See, next year if they transfer then we have to see at the end of the year how will the auditor allow him to keep that transaction open. You have transferred the control to the customer. That other party is enjoying milk in that bottle now. So this year transaction will be closed like this. Next year if he supplies more, you will settle the receivable and payable in the books. Okay. Okay. Scope of Ind AS 5115 continues. Come to the main theory part, paragraph 1.2. First I'll complete this. A contract with customer may partially fall within the scope of 115 and partially within the scope of other standards. In such circumstances, the guidance needs to be applied. What is that guidance? What they're saying, sometimes the transaction may be such that a portion may fall in this standard, a portion of that transaction may fall in some other standard. So if the other standards have any specific guidance and specify how to separate and or initially measure one or more parts of the contract, then an entity shall first apply the separation and or measurement requirement in those standards. If there is another standard dealing with similar issues, so first you check whether in that other standard there is a guidance for initial recognition, measurement, etc. If yes, follow that standard. Example will make the point clear. Omega contracts with a customer to lease an asset and also to provide for its maintenance. So how many contracts are involved here? Which to lease an asset and to provide for maintenance. Does Ind AS 17 deal with maintenance? No. Does Ind AS 17 deal with leases?
Yes.
So now what will happen in this case? The leased asset will be accounted applying the guidance under 1.7, leases. Because AS Ind AS 17 only deals with lease part. It does not deal with how to do accounting of income from maintenance part. And the remaining part of the contract pertaining to maintenance will be accounted as per Ind AS 115. So this is the meaning of this line, that sometimes there can be a contract where a portion of the contract is covered by other standard, like a lease contract and maintenance service, which is a very practical example. And sometime if other standard does not specify how to contract, then this standard will apply to the whole contract. This standard will apply to the entire contract. If other standard do not specify how to separate, then the entity shall apply this standard 115 to separate or initially measure the part or parts of the contract. So you purchase the car, you sell the car, and you also give free service along with the sale of car. So actually there are two contracts like the previous one, but this time sale of car and providing free services, both will be covered by 115. Because we don't have two separate standard dealing with sale of car or providing the free services. So that in that case the entire contract will be covered by 115. Okay. Now we will take a small break.